Thanks for coming. This is going to be fun. I'm Matt Tennikoff, and this is Dan McMurray. We've been asked, and you know, it's an honour to be able to share some thoughts on drum and bass playing. Everyone in here is probably a drum and bass player. Is that right? Mostly? Cool. All right. Let's pray and just set up the session so that, you know, we just align with what God wants us to bring and you to receive. So, and us to receive from you. All right. Good to go? I'll pray. Thanks, God, for this opportunity. And thanks for this whole conference and that this moment is a moment that you've designed, and we're going to share what you put on our hearts, and we just believe that for open hearts, for all these people here, that they can receive, even if it's one thing, but you know that they thank you, God, that you're going to bless them, and they're going to be able to go back and bless their churches and their worlds and their circles of influence, God, in your name, amen. Yeah, Dan, do you want to...
Hello. Guys, thanks for coming. This is rad. There's so many amazing collabs happening at the moment, so thank you for picking this one. And we're so pumped you guys are here. So, yeah, we kind of... we wanted to try and make this as applicable as possible to anyone at any level. Often a lot of these collabs are like... you come along and basically learn, hopefully, how to shred like heaps better, which I wish I could teach that. But I'm sorry to disappoint you, but I can't teach you how to shred. But at the same time, there's a lot of that material online, but we kind of wanted to shape this in a way that was applicable to what we do. Not even just in church, definitely church, but if you find yourself in the professional world outside of church, hopefully it's applicable to that as well. And we kind of wanted to break down as many but specific enough elements and things about drums and bass and what it looks like and kind of how we approach things. So, yeah, we made this incredibly credible looking PowerPoint. So, man, it's incredible. So we wanted to go to one of the media collabs and learn how to make these better, but we couldn't. So, anyway, So we're going to try and break this down into two like main elements, and the first one is the relationships with drums and bass. So if you're taking notes, you can just copy what's up there. But basically, yeah, this is going to be awesome. The relationships of drums and bass. The first one we have is musically, and this is how drums and bass relate to each other musically, but also to music in general, like where they sit in the broad spectrum of what music is, and even just from a practical sense. Basically, drums and bass, I love Nigel Hendroff. Does anyone know who Nigel is? He puts it this way. He says, the drums and bass are the engine room of the band. And I'm okay to take that. I'm like, yeah, you know, it really is. Like, I'll take that any day. There's a lot of responsibility, but it is true because I think that drums and bass hold the most sonic dynamic power. Essentially, if drums and bass aren't playing, it's kind of like, There's so much sonic space that's missing. And even from a practical sense, the way the drums go is you've got a kick, snare, and hats playing a main groove. And the kick is such a low-end sound. And the snare is the middle sound. And the hats are the top. It's covering the entire spectrum of sonic frequencies, essentially. So there's a lot of weight in that. And then obviously bass fills so much of that low and I guess these days high end as well, you know, depends how dirty your dirty channel is, Tom Furby. But yeah, so even from the practical sonic sense, there's so much space taken up by drums and bass. So there's a lot of weight. And often I find in a church setting, if I kind of pull back and stop playing, the whole band kind of goes, oh, like they feel exposed. But often if I feel like we need to go somewhere musically or if there's a flow moment and I feel like we need to kind of grow it, if I start playing, it kind of pushes people to start picking it up. It's just naturally the weight that drums and bass hold. So Yeah, it's like, it's a lot of power, I guess, and you have to use it wisely.
Yeah, and musically too, so exactly what Dan was saying, you've got different, practically, and orally, you know, what we're hearing, when Dan or a drummer is, there's a moment and it's a bigger moment, and all those mid-frequencies are getting filled up because there's a lot of toms and kick and snare going on. There's a whole lot of mid-range that's taken up. So if I then start playing really busy bass in that area, it's really muddy for front of house to go to mix and go, it's just, you know, it's not going to be a clear sound in the room. Sometimes it might sound like a bit of waffle if there's so much mid-range going on. So for a bass, a bit of application musically for bass, when that's going on, sometimes playing less is going to be more effective, because if I play longer notes and then the toms and the kick and that fill out the rest of that bar or two bars, and I just find a nice spot to place a note, that's going to be better sonically to then mix for front of house. And that's what, you know, that's a big deal if it's all muddy. And, and usually in those moments, the singers are going for it and the guitarists are going for it. So me playing less opens all that up to, you know, for a better mix and a better sound. Alternatively, there's always an alternative. If I am going to play busy, then it might be, I might be thinking possibly about bringing some sort of melodic part to that section. If it's a worship section or, you know, a praise moment and there's a lot of sounds going on, one thing that you could do, or I do sometimes, is bring like a little bit of a melodic line. Now, that has a purpose. Everything we do needs a spiritual purpose to it, because we're worshipping. So, a reason why I might bring that is because to encourage the congregation to sing their own song. Like, I don't have a mic to sing, and no one will want to hear me sing in those moments, because I make weird noises. And once I was next to the choir in church, and a really nice lady was like, "Oh, you're singing in there," and I was like, sorry." So, because I knew that I wasn't really singing, I was probably, yeah. And it wasn't good. So,
I do this weird thing where I go, like, in between beats. So if I'm playing like a dum, I'll be like, it's really bad. I was in a studio once and we were trying to figure out where this clicking noise was coming from. And we replaced every cable, like everything. And so the engineer came in and was standing. He's like, just play for me. Like, I need to see if it's like a rattle. And so I was like, and he's like, it's you. You're clicking. And I had no idea. Anyway. Yeah. Singing is a better option.
You're choosing the right approach at the right moment, and you can choose that in the moment. You can go with what your instincts say, and your spirit is feeling like you need to go there, whether that's busy, melodic, open. You've got to just trust your spirit to the Holy Spirit to guide you. You know, you're listening too. You know, we're playing, but we're listening to, and we're getting guided. Kind of wrapping up this section in that is, sometimes, you know, you get a sense of when those moments are going to happen, or what you might play in those moments when you're doing the preparation the week before church. So you know you're going to be on Sunday, but when you rehearse the songs on Wednesday night, you know, and you go over them, you can get a sense, and I'm sure you will do it, but you can get a sense of where that service is going to go. And, you know, that's what happens to me. It gives you confidence in those moments to either bring a part that you might have created during the week to those moments on Sunday, because you go, oh, I've actually been here. It's Sunday now, but when I was practicing in my room on Wednesday, or in front of the couch, I was here, and this part, you know, felt like I needed to write this part or play this bit. And then you bring it on Sunday, knowing that in faith, because you know that God has prompted you on the on the other night. So I get a lot of confidence from my preparation as well to bring those moments in the service. It's not like sometimes, on the other hand too, sometimes it just happens in the service and you go with it. But other times, you know, you get your confidence from the preparation. Yeah, cool. Practically.
So yeah, the next part is practically. The relationships of drums and bass. Practically between us, like what it actually looks like. Typically, like, I don't know about you guys, but keep, like, if you've noticed this or if you do this, but typically the way we start when we're writing parts is that kick drum and bass like hit the same beats, they hit the same notes. You know, a lot of the times for us when we're writing our music, that's what happens. And if you listen to all kinds of music, they kind of usually hit the same beats in the bar. And that's kind of like what helps drive. But that's also what creates the pocket and the feel of the song. But that's not always the case. Sometimes, I mean, we have an example I'll show you, but sometimes the bass and drums don't actually play the same beats. One thing I love about Matt is he'll think, rather than just hearing like kick pattern, because we were running over some of the new songs yesterday and kind of like ironing out some patterns, and rather than hearing my kick pattern and just copying it, he'll go, actually, it's going to feel better if I hit a note on your snare where you're not hitting a kick, and it actually ends up feeling amazing and musically suits the song more. But either way, whether the kick and the bass are hitting the same notes or beats or whatever, they have to complement each other. I can't be playing something, he's playing something completely different, and musically it doesn't make sense just because we're not listening to each other. It needs to complement each other, and it needs to complement the music. So that's kind of like, between drums and bass, it practically it looks like a lot of locking in together and hitting the same parts, hitting the same beats. But it ultimately just has to be what's best for the song, what's best musically in the moment. Do you want to do the God Solo?
Yeah, let's play that. We'll go from the back of the field.
Yeah, so there's this new song. I think, did we do it yesterday? Cool. It's called God Say Love. It's a beautiful song. And we were running over it yesterday, and I actually have changed the beat from the original one. And we're just going to play it, and I guess we'll play it, talk about it.
Yeah, just the bridge bit where the vocals, before the vocals come in.
Should we do like...
Do the bridge.
Nah. Yep.
That's probably because this is what happens in new song season. Confession. I was singing the wrong song in my head for the whole first half.
Yeah, I wasn't even singing the song.
I
don't know the word. I do know the words, but I don't know the melody. God's alone.
I was singing so good to me.
I was still probably singing the chorus over the bridge chords, so we got there. It was a good example, I feel. Yeah. I didn't play on your kick too much. Yeah. But that probably wasn't even the song. Yeah. The click makes weird noises sometimes. It's like, yeah, so... Yeah. So you would have heard how Dan's kick is very busy in some parts, and Dan will tell you why it changes a lot. Dan thinks a lot about patterns per bar, so an A bar, and which is a four beats, and then another four beats, might repeat that, and then he'll go to an alternate B rhythm, and then maybe back to A. So that's how we communicate a bit A, B, A. But what I try and do with some of these new songs is just find a pattern that's going to flow through the whole section, and not get too funky on the bass, on the beats. Because there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of track and that's happening as well. So if I'm busy and bouncy on the kick, you know, and Dan's following the melody with some of the rhythms, then it's just getting all, you know, it's getting a lot of there's just a lot of sound going on and a lot of bass going on, and for me it just feels too busy. So to open it up a bit more and support Dan and the music and just lay a foundation, I keep it simple and just try to find a pattern that's going to work through his A and B's and A's, and then his improvised bars where you forget.
But that also determines how much space a song has. It's like if we're busy up the parts, it makes it feel more cluttered, which is sometimes the right thing, but sometimes it needs the space. So determining where we place our beats determines how much space that. But we can. I think we're going to touch on that more because we're going to talk about writing parts later. But it's like that's kind of the effect we have. Space and how it feels in the pocket and what pushes it and stuff. So,
We'll go on relationally.
Relationally. Oh. This is an interesting one because I feel like a lot of people don't often touch on this. And to be honest, if you're like trying to land a gig with a band or a tour or something, it's often not something that's assessed and a qualifying factor, but relationally, person to person, the chemistry. I think it's so important because when you have a relationship with someone, you know them, you know their tendencies, you know how they react to things, you can tell when they're in a certain mood, you can tell when they're not feeling well. When you have that relationship, and music is a conversation, whether you're listening to it or playing it, it's a conversation. There's a lot of ins and outs, there's a lot of ups and downs, and it's a dialogue, a musical dialogue. And in the same way, you would have a conversation with someone and read their body language and kind of understand where they're at with it, with the conversation. Music's the same thing. So when I play with someone a lot, I kind of know their body language, and to me, they're communicating to me, and I know exactly where to go, and I know what to do. And I think that having like a personal relationship is so important, and the personal side of it is actually, to me, what brings the joy into a lot of the time into music. Because to me, it's more about who you share a stage with rather than what you're doing. Because I've played some shows that would be like cool, I guess, and in cool venues and stuff, but the people on stage, I don't really know them. And there's not much relationships. And so it actually creates this real weird divide. So, but I could be in a tiny venue with bad sound, like bad gear, and two people that showed up. But if I'm with my friends and we're just making music and jamming and we're like loving life together, like doing the journey together, it's crazy how much of a difference that makes. And I think in the personal life side as well, but on stage, knowing each other, knowing all of that really helps kind of flow and feel everything out. I actually have a video example. Anyone know who Omar Rodriguez Lopez is? He's like a crazy guitarist, plays for a lot of things. But I love this example, and if you kind of watch, this is actually a long video, it's like 6 minutes long, but we're only going to watch like 30 seconds or a minute. So they've basically been jamming for about 5 minutes, and nothing's scripted. Like, you can tell they're kind of just jamming, doing their thing. But they're all playing together, they've all played together so much that you can tell they're just vibing off each other and reading each other. And Omar is the guy, he's playing guitar and he's wearing glasses. And there's a moment, I want you to look for it, there's a moment where they're all jamming and he starts playing something on his guitar and they all start just staring at him. They all just start looking at him, watching him. And he hasn't like done anything crazy. He just starts playing a certain thing on his guitar. They all start looking at him. And he does one little body language thing. He pushes his glasses up. He, like, yells something. And they all completely change what they're doing in a second. And it's like you can tell that it's just because of they have that chemistry in that relationship. But rather than talking about it, I want you to see it. So if you don't mind, guys at the back. Did anyone notice that? So it's like one thing to watch it here, but when you've actually watched the entire journey, the 6 minutes, you realize that all of a sudden they all change their posture. And they've literally just been jamming the whole time, like kind of doing their thing. They're all like doing crazy stuff. And all of a sudden, everything just shifts and they kind of, Omar, it's his group. It's called the Omar Rodriguez Lopez group. So he's the head of it. And he just kind of changes his posture, his body language, and they're all on board, and he just does something and then they all bring it down. And I love that because so many times in worship that happens. So many times the worship leader will do something with their body and I can tell they're actually going to go somewhere, but it's also because I know them. It's also because I have a relationship with them, and it's over time, and it's like a chemistry thing. And I think it's so important. So it's not kind of like when you come up to church on a weekend or go to a show or something, don't think, oh, we just have to do our job and get out of here. Like, do life with each other, because you actually find that the moments that God does, the things that God does in a service, you actually then get to share together, and it actually unites us and binds us. And I think it's a really special thing.
And when you have that relationship too, you know, there's a lot of respect there. So if Dan is sensing in a service that he's going to build and we're going to go somewhere, I'm going to go. I'm jumping on board. In 2 milliseconds, I'm on board and I'm going to build because, you know, we're on the same page, and I got a lot of respect for Dan. So if he's feeling it and he's going there, I know he's sensing it for a reason. So I'm going to go with that. Even if I'm not feeling it at that moment, I'm there. I'm with you, you know. So, and you pray for each other. There's a really special bond between, there's something special with drums and bass, that what you bring in the service is a whole lot of strength. So, pray for each other and get on board spiritually about what you're bringing, and spend time with each other. Like it's great over conference and new song season that like we got to spend hours yesterday just going over practically talking about where we're going to play beats and notes and that was really cool. The reason we did that is because that's going to strengthen when we play together, we know where it's going to be. So, you know, if you're just turning up and playing and thinking it's all good, you can miss some things. Sometimes you can't get together, but you know, when you can, it's good. And there's a reason behind it. It's to bring strength to the service as well.
One thing I think is really cool that I've experienced is some of the guys I play with at church and serve with are like family and best friends. And when you know someone's going through something or dealing with something in life, or you kind of understand maybe they're sick, maybe their wife's sick or something's happening, you actually, in worship, get to kind of like play to them and play for them and push through for them and pray. One thing I love, this is actually the best. Do you guys know Harrison? He played drums last night and this morning. He's amazing and the best. And so he's kind of been dealing with some pain in his shoulders and stuff over the last like couple of years, and I was talking to him to last night afterwards, and I was just, you know, encouraging him, saying how good it was, and he's like, it's the coolest thing. I was drumming and I could feel that people were praying for me. I could feel this weight and this power, like, just kind of come up behind me and support me and hold, you know, keep me strong. And like, because there was a few guys that prayed for him before he went on, and then even just during the service, I was praying for him, and a bunch of our drummer guys, we all got each other's backs. And I just think that's such a powerful thing that you don't really get in a lot of industries. You don't really get in a lot of parts of music and life. And I love that. That's a perfect example of, if I don't know Harry, even though we're not sharing a stage together, but the idea of relationship, if I don't know where someone's at, I can't pray for them or help them or anything. But when we're on stage, if I know someone's dealing with something, the same way if I ask God to point someone out who's at church to play for them, I can play for the people on stage and like pray over them. And I think that's worship in a beautiful, beautiful way. And as someone who drums a lot outside of church, the Christian world, I've done a lot of just normal mainstream gigs. The same principle applies, because God is God and his power is everywhere that you are. And so I've prayed for people that don't even know him on a stage, and just the journey they go on, like you see him work through you. So don't be discouraged if you're like, I don't really do church stuff, like, even though a lot of you do. It applies anywhere. Cool. So remember at the start I said there was two parts. The first one was the relationship of drums and bass. The second part is the application of drums and bass. Beep, 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 beep. I don't know what that was. That was like that siren horn thing. Is everyone okay? How's everyone doing? Okay, great. If you need to stand up and like stretch or something, you can.
We'll do some questions at the end, so keep them in mind. Write them down. Bring them up.
We'll ask, if you want to ask questions, you can. Mm. I forgot to say that. That was my bad.
It's in there now.
Cool. Yeah. The first part of the application of drums and bass is playing as one. Practically, what that looks like. A major part of pocket and the feel of drums and bass is where the hits are placed around the beat. And often, so there's kind of like, the word groove is so, there's so many, you could talk about groove for 2 hours because there's so many different terms and meanings, and I don't know, who loves groove? Who knows what it is? I don't. So, but in the best way to explain it, I do know, I'm sorry. Matt's incredible at music, so I'm honored to share a stage with him and say things that don't make sense. But often like the groove and the feel of the drums and bass, it's where you place things on the beat. So does anyone know what I'm talking about? So if you have a click, whether it's on the beat, behind the beat, in front of the beat, that kind of affects how the song feels and all of that. But playing as one sometimes doesn't even look like playing in the same place, or it might mean playing the same place. I actually have some audio examples. So playing on the beat, I think this is a good example, and I've asked people's opinions because sometimes it can feel one or the other. It can feel ahead, it can feel behind. I think this is a good example of just on the beat. If something's on the beat, it feels even paced. It feels like it's kind of just going at a steady rate. And this is the example I have. So that's an example, I think. It's just, do you guys know what I mean? It just feels like it's just cruising. It just feels good. That's what I would consider playing on the beat. And then an example I have for playing behind the beat. Behind makes it feel relaxed. Some people would say draggy, but I would say relaxed because I tend to play behind the beat all the time. Or sometimes not to the beat at all, as you could see earlier. So this song.
Be the one for you. Doesn't matter what you're going through, you're gonna keep on saying.
feels so good. But see how the drums are kind of, especially that hi-hat, it's just hinting behind the beat. And it makes you feel like you kind of just want to sit back in your chair a bit. Did you guys hear that? And then I have an example of in front of the beat, and this is almost painful to listen to, but it is incredible. So it's funny because this brings me to my next point. Did anyone notice that other instruments were kind of messing with the beat and the drums felt like they were pushing it forward and playing really ahead of the beat? So they were playing ahead of the beat, but other instruments were also sitting behind. And so I think that sometimes it's not always just the drums job or even the bass job to sit around the beat to create the feel in the pocket. Sometimes it's our job when we're playing together to kind of go, all right, where do we want to sit? And how is that going to musically affect what the other instruments are playing? I've got one more example, if that's okay. So this, to me, just listen to the piano. Something about this piano and the other instruments in it. Hear that? Everyone's just playing everywhere, but they're all locking in and playing as one. So I don't know if you have any thoughts.
Yeah, really good, Dan. We use a lot of tracks. The only time we may not use a track is if when we go off the track and so we go to a different section or that, so, or it gets to the end of the song set. But the track kind of in a lot of those times sets the feel in the pocket of the song. And as a bass player too, sometimes a lot of the synth parts are in the bass. So if I'm playing behind the track and in the track it's on, it's bad. It's really bad because you've got this like flam sort of bass line happening, which isn't going to work. So you need I need to understand the pocket of the track. Usually praise is going to be up and on the beat, and worship's going to be more back. And usually in worship, the track's not going to have so much driving bass parts. So, you know, it's easier to sit in the groove with a drummer. But yeah, and so that also comes down to a mixing thing as well. If I don't have a good level of track in my ear, then I'm going to play off it and I'm not going to be playing as one in the pocket. You know, our role is to play like play together, but when there's other rhythmic elements going on and if we're not with it because I can't hear it, it's going to sound bad out the front. So yeah, it's three elements of groove that are going on. It's myself and locking in with the drums, but also together locking in with the track. Yeah. That's what I was going to add to that.
That's awesome. The next part is writing parts. So I guess we could talk about this for hours, but we won't. But anyone here either write songs or a part of a church that writes songs and you find yourself needing to make up parts for them? Awesome. I think that like helps you understand why we write parts and why the parts are important, because sometimes they take such a big journey to get to the part that they end up as. Some kick patterns will spend an hour just going through everything we can think of to find the one that feels right. And so even if you don't write parts yourself, even if you don't find yourself in a situation where you actually get to do this, understanding the process helps you appreciate the parts that are there musically. And it kind of adds a bit of power to what you're doing, kind of adds a bit of purpose and a little bit of conviction to just playing these songs in church or wherever, or any song, no matter what it is. Understanding the process behind writing parts can be like make or break, you know.
I want to just jump in on that, Dan.
Please.
When you're all writers, and you know, you should feel confident to bring new ideas to the service. Every time we play a song, it's not exactly the same as recording the album. The album's one night in a moment, and it's that special, but that's next week. You know, the song can be different, and the song's in a different environment, and the song is ministering to people that have gone through the previous week and need a new, need to be ministered to in a different way. So, you know, you should feel like you are writers, because every service is different, and you should feel confident to bring something different to that service. So, everyone's hands should have gone up then. You're all writers. Even though you're not writing, the parts we write, the parts I write on albums, change them. You know, bring a different idea to a service, learn it and that, but then feel confident enough to go, oh, it's different environment, different drummer, you know, different situation. Let's bring a different idea, a different sound. Maybe you not do it on the bass, do it on the synth in this service, because it's not going to be the first song, it's going to be the second song, so it might be leading into worship. And, bring different elements to and ideas to the songs that are there. Yeah?
100%. Even for our church, we have many different services happen across the week. So sometimes they're in the CC where we're having conference, and sometimes they're in rooms smaller than this. So you can't just play the same thing all the time. You have to think what's best for this room, what's best for this moment, but still do the songs justice, you know? And that's actually, I think, the main first principle apart with writing parts is it has to work for the song, it has to do the song justice, and it has to complement it. You know, I could come in and be like, I've just been practicing this awesome 13-16 double kick, like paradiddle diddle 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 pattern during the week, and just try and play it for a song, but it's not necessarily going to work for the song. So I have to. That's the main thing. So I know for me, when we sit down in a workshop to workshop a song, I listen to three main things. Was that Transformer? Is there a Transformer in here? bad joke. I listen to three main things. I listen to the lyrics. So what's the song about? I listen to the melodic rhythm. And then I listen to... So I'm trying to find my notes. And I listen to the melody. So what's the emotion being created? Is the melody really pretty? Is the melody really cold? And I think what you have to do is figure out what works best for your brain. Like, figure out how you best process and approach writing parts, because some people are very logical, but some people are very feel it. And I'm one of those guys, is like, I just have to trust my instinct, and I have to trust musically what I first feel. So the first thing I do when someone shows us a song or whatever is, okay, what's the song about? What am I naturally feeling? What are the rhythms that are like I would naturally want to do? And that's where I start. And I then iron it out from there. Sometimes the very first thing I play is what makes it, and sometimes we have to go through 50 versions to get it there. But that's how I start. That's the thing I listen to is like, I'm going to use Beautiful Name as an example. You guys know that song. It's a very good song. But that, if you listen to the lyrics of that song, the lyrics of the first chorus is, what a beautiful name it is. And the name of Jesus. So the lyrics are actually very tender. The word beautiful is, it's beautiful. It's a very tender, intimate word. But then you get to the bridge and it's like, the heavens are roaring. You have no rival. You have no equal. Forever you reign. They're like quite triumphant lyrics. So when I was writing the parts for that song, I couldn't just pick one emotion and write that way the whole time. I had to kind of go, okay, the verses feel very beautiful, like you were the word at the beginning, God's own son. Like, it's very kind of tender and it does the job, but it's not in your face and it's not aggressive. But then when you get to that bridge, like, you're kind of compelled to do something like that's going to break walls down. Do you know what I mean? It's like you have that feeling where you just want to stomp and shout. And so that's an example where you have to listen to what the lyrics are saying. You could put any lyrics with that song and it might completely change musically what the journey that happens, you know? And the same with the melodic rhythm. People are singing these songs. So if you're playing something that's distracting or that actually like clashes with it, it's not comfortable. ultimately we're creating the bed for people to sing on top of, and you want people to not have to think. You don't want people to go, oh, this is really awkward to sing, this is really uncomfortable, why? And it's because I'm doing something stupid on the drums, or, you know, Matt's doing some crazy Salvation Is Here bass line that's amazing. Sorry, sneaky plug, sneaky shout out. Yeah. Anyway, you want people to naturally be able to sing these songs and it feels good. So I often write parts with the melody. Beautiful Name is a good example. I'm going to play the beat in the verse.
Yeah, pitch it to in your head. Think about the words and the melody, because you can hear what Dan's talking about.
Do you want me to play on top of the track? You get the point. But often, thank you. That's your drum solo for the day, guys, so you can take those chops away. But often, like, people will hear that beat and go, oh, that's really creative, like, that's really cool, like, it sounds awesome. But I'm literally playing what the melody says. I'm playing what a... I can't drum in. That's why there's a stand. If you have a listen, I'll play the chorus again. Listen. Thank you. I appreciate your help. So the melodic rhythm is, and that's the beat I'm playing. So it's actually not that rocket science-y. I took the melody and I was like, okay, that's a melodic rhythm. What can I write around it? And so the next part to it is, how can I, instead of just going, okay, this is the beat I'm going to play. You know, which could be awesome for a song, maybe. I kind of thought of creative ways to then go back to what I was saying. What's going to make this feel good for what the lyrics are saying? What's going to make it feel sweet and intricate, because this song is very intricate in that sense of what it's saying and how it feels. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So honestly, that's like one of the biggest things is sometimes the melodic rhythm can completely give you your part. It has to complement, it has to feel good to sing over, but it doesn't mean you have to just play something completely straight and boring. But sometimes the straight, most simple things work. Same song, same example. The kick pattern in the chorus is literally this. There's nothing crazy exciting about that, but it just feels really good. And that comes back to the space thing that we were talking about before. The more beats there are, the less space there is. But something about when you land that chorus, you just want it to feel like it just sings and it breathes and it has space. Because then you get to the bridge and there's no space. And because you don't want space.
And this bit here about writing parts is just to share some approaches. It's just, this is Dan's approach, this is my approach. Come up with your own, and you can go, I don't like Matt's approach to writing parts, but I like Dan's, or I like this thing from Dan's. I'm a bass player, but I like how much he listened to the melody. And then take that on board for when you're writing and creating and coming up with parts. So, you know, I learn a lot from sussing out what I don't like as well. So, you know, feel free to not like it, but also feel free to like it. and take a few things from it. So I can share how I write as well. Every song, every album, every conference, every project is different, and I feel like I need to align with what God's purpose is for that. Whether it's 2 minutes in a song, or whether it's a week or a few days of conference, there's a purpose, there's a role that I need to play, and something I need to personally bring to that. And I approach songs the same way as I approach work and life, and that's what's my purpose, what's my role, and aligning with that journey. So songs are the same. So we just did the Christmas album, Peace Project, and Rolf was on that one mostly, and we prayed before the whole project, and just felt like the word for us to how to approach that album was to build the foundations of a cathedral. And so it's like, well, you're not carpenters and you're not stonemasons, but the image that puts in my mind is that something beautiful is going to get built on top of some strong and simple foundations. And so that was how I and Rolf approached every song: simple, strong, and that other and leave space for other things to get built on top of. Foundations aren't seen, foundations aren't noticed a lot of the times, but some beautiful things and strong things are built on top. Now, when that worked out really well, because when the project came out, it had all the orchestral sounds on it, and all of that, which we didn't know when we were writing before, but what we kind of asked God, and He said, "Do this," and then everything else was built on top of it. So, but then with this current album, my approach is different again. In just listening to the songs, it's about just finding moments and specific tones, and working, a lot with keeping it pretty simple in most of the parts, because letting the lyrics carry the song rather than coming up with hooks and parts, which is a different approach than albums in the past. From Wonder was a whole different album. Wonder was about pushing, Joel was going play more, and I worked with G Hay on that, and it was just about being melodic in a lot of the songs and coming up with part. There's one song about love, I can't remember that, and when G Hay and I were starting to write that part, we thought it was going to be simple, and then Joel came in and he's like, "No, I want it really melodic." So we wrote. Crafted like a melodic part through it, and then, you write these parts, and then you don't know what's going to be put on top of them a lot of the time. So that's why it's really important for me to align with what's happening. Because one of the verses we wrote was for a guitar solo that originally when we put this track down, wrote the bass part for it. There was a big cool solo over the top of it. But then when the album came out, it was a verse that Taya sings, and that bass line stayed the same, it didn't change. So you're just going with your instincts and you're going with your spirit and you feel it, but I need to align with it. Every song's different. There's a, want to share about a song called As It Is, and I got that as a demo, and I had to listen to it probably 10 to 12 times before I even felt like I could approach that song and putting any ideas to it. Like every time I listened to it, I would cry, and I was broken by that song. And until I was broken, spiritually by that song, and had an understanding about the weight of it, I didn't feel like I could write a part. I just felt a huge conviction: don't even try to come up with something yet. And it was like, okay, I'll listen to it again. Cry again, listen to it again, cry again, listen to it in the car, cry again. And it took a long time. And then really there's not a part, I'm just following the kicks and things on that. It's just in the last, the very last verse or section of that song where the bass kind of cuts loose a little bit. But that was for me like a kind of release of being broken by that song, just in that very last bit. And there's not anything specific there. It just hits a few specific parts of the melody and supports that. But for me, that was like I haven't been affected by a song that much before actually being able to approach it. And another thing is, one way I like to going to jump ahead. Some when you write a part two, it doesn't mean it's always it's going to be liked by everyone. 2 days ago was the first time we got together with Mikey and did some rehearsal, and I had an idea for Still, and played it in rehearsal, and I thought it was awesome. I thought it was going to change lives and save the world, but Mikey was like, nope, not happening. And so, you write a part, but you bring it to the song and you bring it to the people, you bring it open-handed. And, knowing that if it gets no, it's okay, because for me, the writing process is a worship process. If I spend hours and hours and hours and hours and hours and hours and hours, and hours writing a song and listening to it and re-listening to it and recording it and then playing it in my car and then listening to it, analysing it and going, no, that's not going to go there, that's going to go there. It's just time with God and spending worship, because we're in worship songs. So none of that for me is wasted time, and it doesn't matter if someone says no, it's okay. Take that on board too when you're writing and you're thinking of ideas, and you might go, oh, I brought this idea to the service. I've got this really good part in the bridge. It's going to really say people. And then if the worship leader's like, nah, that's not going to happen, that's okay, because you just spent your time trying to craft a part and trying to listen to where the Spirit might be guiding you in that section of the song. Yeah, and aligning your technique and your tone and your skill with your Spirit and trying to come up with something that's, that can represent what you're feeling. Yeah.
That's good, bro. Love it. That's awesome. For the sake of time, we'll just rush through this one. We're going to let you guys out in T-minus 6 minutes. Is that all right? Is that cool? Cool. The third one is executing our role. And basically, this is applicable to anyone, because there's so many elements to doing what we do. And one huge thing is preparation. I often think that, like, as a drummer, it's hard. I've always lived in apartments, basically, since I left home. And I don't know about you, but living in an apartment doesn't mean you can really thrash away on a drum kit. So basically, for the last 10 years of my life, I've practiced on pillows and practiced in my head. And sometimes I've rehearsed and learned like 15 songs for an entire tour, and the first time I play them on a drum kit is the sound check for the first night. And it's like figuring out how to actually prepare as best you can when the circumstances aren't ideal is awesome as well. Figuring out how you best prepare and best learn things. Some of our guys, like Harry and Simon Kobler, who drums for United, they have to chart out things on tabs. Like, if I'm like, hey, here's the new part, and I beatbox it to them, they're like, I don't know what you're doing, give me a tab. And I'm the opposite. Like, if they give me a tab, I'm like, what's this gibberish? Like, just beatbox it to me, and I've got it. So preparing whatever way you can is key, and you can really set yourself up for a win. There's no excuses, really. It's kind of like, sure, I might not have a drum kit, but I can still listen to the song. I can still tell my body, my muscle memory, what to do. Muscle memory is the biggest gift, I think, because the whole point of what we do is to be able to focus on what God's doing. And so when you learn a song for church, when you can play it without having to focus on every part, you can actually set your attention to the Holy Spirit. You can set your sights on God and what he's doing in the service and where it's going. And you don't even have to think about what you're playing. And that's, for me, the biggest goal. Like, you want to get to that point, I think. I'm trying to fly through this. There's like, we could do like a 2-hour thing. But
question?
Should we do questions?
Yeah, like two, probably, because it's four.
Do you guys have any questions?
Yeah, is there anything?
You got a question? Do you want to,
you're talking about writing parts before. Yeah. Now, in Wonder, the album Wonder, that first song, like, those grooves or those chops.
Yeah. Well, so Simon Kobler drummed on that, on those songs, but I was same thing what you do with Jihei. I was there, I helped write the parts. So like with Wonder, that was actually funny because that was the first song we did when we started the album in LA. And I remember hearing it, like the first time they played it through, I was like, this is awesome. All the parts are there. What actually happened was the guys who wrote the song went to New York. So I think it was Matt Crocker, Joel, and Dylan, and I think Mikey Chislett, who produces everything. They were at Joel's house for like 3 weeks working on songs, and they actually wrote that digga-digga-da-da-dum, the Tom thing, and the whole feel, kind of, they actually came up with that. Like, they did a MIDI demo of it. So I actually have no idea how they did that process, but it's perfect. And then when it goes double time at the end, like, it's just so cool. So I'm with you, man. I'm like, that's awesome. I don't know the approach because they just made a MIDI demo and that's what they played. Like, but for Glimmer and Dust, that was a process because Cobes is a genius. Like, the way he thinks about parts and music is just freakish. And the whole song, he just was feeling it and jamming it, and it just became what it is. But then when it got to the end, we were in the live room, everyone's sitting at instruments, and there was this conversation where it was like, we don't want it to just go to a big open groove, you know, like, how can we make this epic? And so everyone just kind of threw out some ideas. I think Matt Crocker was like, oh, why don't you try halftime? So instead of going doom, ga, why don't you try going doom, ga? And then I was like, well, why don't you try and fill in those gaps? Like, maybe you could go ga. Like, we kind of just how good's drummer talk? Ga, 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 blah, 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 blah. Yeah, so we kind of just, it was a real collaborative thing. And then when it came to doing those the actual fills, it probably took us like an hour to record it because every section, Cobes was trying to remember, like, we talked specifically about every, this feels going to be this, like, because it just felt awesome. And then the one part, you know, the last one, how it's like, digga, 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 and it overlaps the bar. That was a mistake. So he's recording it and we're like, we're finally on the last bar. And he was like, digga, 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 digga. And he yells, he's like, ah, man, I messed it up. Like, and we were like, it sounded incredible. Do that again. Like, make that mistake again. And it ends up being the coolest thing ever. So sometimes these things just happen and they're simple, but sometimes that you labor over them and you think, how can we make this awesome? And yeah, that was that.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Sorry, guys. It's a long answer.
Yeah. No, it's good. Thanks for
that. Wow, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. So thanks for coming and come and, you know, if you see myself or Dan or Furby, anyone walking around, come and say hi and ask questions and give feedback.
Yep.
Thanks. Thanks, production.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for coming.